Everyone, and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Welfare Reform Committee for 2014. Could everyone please make sure that their mobile phones and electronic equipment is switched off? We have a slightly shorter meeting than usual today, although that depends on how many questions we've got for our witnesses. But the publication of the Heriot Watt University evaluation of the Scottish Welfare Fund has been delayed, and we can't take that evidence as we had planned today. So we move to agenda item 1. And the first item of business is a decision on whether to take item 5 of this meeting, which is consideration of the committee's work programme in private, and whether to take the consideration of draft reports on food banks and sanctions in private at all future meetings. Have members agreed? Okay, thank you very much. That takes us to agenda item 2. And the second item of business is our first evidence session for some time on the issue of personal independence payments. The contract for undertaking personal independent payments assessments is held by ATOS, as it was for the work capability assessments. However, in much of Scotland, they have been subcontracted out to Salus, which I and other Lanarkshire members know is the occupational health arm of NHS Lanarkshire. I'd like to welcome Mark Kennedy, who's the general manager of Salus, and Kenny Small, who's the director of human resources at NHS Lanarkshire, both to the table. Members may recall that we invited both Mark and Kenny to the committee last year when they set out how they intended to implement the contract. We have left the return until this point when the contract has been running for some months so that they would have some concrete evidence to provide to us. They have done, and I thank them very much for their written submissions, but I know that you want to make some opening comments, so I'll hand it over to you. I don't know if you're both going to say something or one of you. Kenny, I'll just go to you first then. Okay.
Thank you very much. And we appreciate the opportunity to come back and update the Welfare Reform Committee in relation to the PIP contract held by Salus. We believe it's a positive story, and in a minute or two Mark will talk you through the paper to give you some of the statistics and performance evidence in terms of our delivery of this contract. And certainly from our perspective, with, as you would kind of expect with a complex contract such as this, some teething problems in the very early stages, but we now believe that we've got beyond those early teething problems, the vast majority of which were not really of our own making, but we have got beyond that, and are now at a stage where we really believe that the contract is going to pick up and run in a very favourable way. So with those very few introductory comments, I'll hand over to Mark to talk you through the paper and then hopefully open that up for questions.
Okay. Good morning. Following on from Kenny, it's a kind of high-level report you've been submitted with, which gives you some statistics from when we commenced in July. It's been running for 9 months now. We have led consultations for around 7,000 claimants to date. All of them face-to-face from 8 venues around Scotland, mainly the west of Scotland plus Edinburgh City. We have had only 5 complaints to date from the claimants going through the process. The consultation, you may remember previously from our last year, the consultation time was under review, and that has now settled down due to a number of IT problems settling and more familiarity with the assessors to around about 90 minutes or so. So we are currently providing around, each assessor will provide around 4 consultations per day comfortably now. And we feel to do more than that at this moment in time would be detrimental to the claimant in terms of the duration of the assessment. We are anticipating round about, by the end of the calendar year, around about 30,000, 31,000 consultations offered. And probably by that time, certainly we have a workforce at the moment of around 26 or so health practitioners, NHS-based health practitioners. At our peak, hopefully in August, September, we will be employing around 37. At that point, we'll be at full capacity and offering around 3,000 PIP assessment slots per month following that time. We have had some consultation. If you remember, we were determined to take this initiative forward with the ethos and compassion of the NHS at the centre of this. We have invited consultation around from disability groups across Scotland. We put on an open day. We had about 7 representatives from those groups at that day. And I personally went and presented to the Scottish Social Security Consortium last November. And really that was just a transparent from day one of your claim, this is how Salus would intend to work with you through the claim. So we feel we are delivering a high quality service. We have had informal feedback from both ATOS and DWP that we're among the highest quality in the UK in terms of the report writing that we're submitting. And as I say, we haven't had to date, touch wood, many complaints from the general public that are going through the process. So it seems to be settling down and seems to be working well, in my opinion.
Okay, thanks very much. We'll go to the questions now. Can I start off just by asking a couple of questions? You said 7,000 assessments carried out so far and potentially around 30,000, 31,000 by the end of the year. Is that where you expect it to be? Are you ahead of schedule in respect to that, behind schedule? Have you been set targets and are you meeting those targets essentially?
We're round about, at present, we're on line for where we want to be. Kenny touched on, you may remember at the start, the volumes were a bit inaccurate in what the flow of claimants would be to the service. So there is a degree of catch-up required by ATOS and DWP. The way it works for us is we provide appointment slots every month in advance to ATOS, who then fill those slots on our behalf. So our conversation with ATOS is that we will provide you at our fullest capacity 3,000 slots per month, and that's the maximum we can do. So we're kind of there now, almost with the maximum capacity. Regarding performance overall, I would suggest that there's still a bit of catch-up to be done. Not by Salus, I have to say, but that has to flow from DWP and ATOS's figures. Okay. Don't know if I explained that right. We can only
You were set a target. I mean, my understanding was that the DWP wanted to see a reduction in the amount of claims or a reduction in the amount of money being claimed by the overall number of people going through the system. Is that right?
Not from a Salus perspective. There is no target setting in this for Salus at all. We deliver an assessment that DWP have endorsed. We have no quota of how many people should either pass or fail that assessment.
I think the target that Salus exclusively works to is a target about the number of available assessment slots and the production of those assessments. What happens thereafter is not part of our responsibility or our contractual liability.
Okay. Anecdotally, and you know, obviously the statistics will start to show whether this is true or not, but anecdotally, when we have, as a committee, been meeting with organisations across Scotland about the new changes, we're picking up some concerns in relation to PIP about the criteria. Now, we had these with the work capability assessment, and I think we've proven and other people have proven that the work capability assessment criteria doesn't actually provide any evidence that people are fit to work. They're deemed to be, in most cases, very, very unfair and serve very little purpose in terms of assessing people for work. Do you believe that the criteria you've been given to assess people by is fair and actually provide you with something that you're comfortable assessing in order to determine whether people are entitled to this new PIP benefit?
Absolutely. I think it's fair in terms of, you pointed out our background is in occupational health and assessing people's functionality is something what we've been doing for decades. I can clearly state NHS Lanarkshire wouldn't be involved in this if we didn't think it was a fair process to be involved in. I haven't picked up any anecdotal evidence at all of people being unhappy with the assessment and the numbers that we've put through as yet, but I also accept we haven't had any formal report from DWP. As yet in PIP, to my knowledge. So, yes, I think we are delivering a fair assessment in a compassionate manner.
Just to give you an example then, as to why I'm asking the question about the fairness. It was brought to my attention at one of the meetings that we had that one of the people who was going for assessment had been asked whether they could walk a certain distance. They had difficulty doing that. They said that they could probably on some occasions walk the distance that was required, but they felt that the test was set up to make them fail because the assessment centre that they were asked to go to required you to walk from the car park to the assessment centre which was a distance greater than the test. Therefore, if you made it from the car park into the assessment centre, you'd effectively proven that you weren't entitled to the benefit, and they thought that that was inherently unfair because you're keyed up to go in for an assessment, you want to get there, but that doesn't actually measure your normal ability or capability to walk a certain distance. That type of unfairness was what was being brought to your attention. Would you like to comment on that?
I can categorically say that is not happening in our Salus-led provision. We do not take assumptions into consideration of that. Where our assessment starts is when the individual presents themselves at reception in the building. I have heard these stories before. I'm not sure what company they're related to, but they're certainly not related to NHS Lanarkshire's approach in this. I have heard bits and pieces of where bus stops are, in relation to, and I can categorically go on record that that is not the case here. As soon as the individual presents within the facility, then the assessor, the way it works in our premises, is the assessor will meet the individual at the desk and escort them to their consultation room. The consultation room could be 10 metres away, it could be 50, depending on where they are. But no assumptions like that are ever taking place.
I think it's important to recognise that the initial estimation of how long an assessment would take, and our current experience are very different. Our current experience is that an assessment of an individual is taking between 90 and 110 minutes. So it's not a short assessment. It does not involve any snap judgments. It is very much an opportunity, a relaxed opportunity, we believe, for an individual to tell us their story and to use a prompting set of questions for people to tell us what effect their disability has on their normal everyday life. And that's what the assessment process does. It allows people a relaxed opportunity to walk us through the implications of their disability in relation to their everyday life. And that informs the assessment process that we then submit. So no, as Mark says, no assumptions beforehand and no tricks.
I know from previous conversations I've had with you yourself, Kenny, but also from evidence we took from ATOS, that there was a dialogue between the companies carrying out the assessments and the DWP. Now, ATOS said that some criteria had been changed. They had raised some issues about the work capability assessment and some modifications to the criteria or the assessment process had taken place. Has that happened with you? What has the response been if you've had to go back to the DWP to discuss those types of issues?
We haven't, have we?
We have not been asked at all to alter or consider alterations to the assessment tool, as it were, in that case. What there have been some IT changes that make it a bit easier for the health practitioner to go through in a more timely fashion, but there haven't been any major changes at all that we've been asked to implement.
What you might be referring to is right at the very beginning, the clinical director of Salus, Dr. Imran Ghafoor, was heavily involved with ATOS and DWP making comments around the clinical governance aspects of the original assessment. And I think there were some tweaks made at that time, but that was, it was in the early stages. I think it was before we even launched the process that ATOS and DWP were using some clinical professionals, experienced clinical professionals, to road test the assessment process. But since we have launched this, the assessment process has been what it is now.
Yeah. The ATOS went to great lengths to try and assure us that they had been in a constant dialogue with the DWP in order to try and get some of the assessment changes made, because they were picking up from practice things that they were concerned about and had raised them with the DWP. And I just wondered if that was your experience.
No. I think if the conversation may be around process rather than the actual assessment itself. They did have problems, significant problems with IT at the start. I know that was one of the things they were actively discussing with DWP.
Okay. I'll open up to committee members. I'll go to the Deputy Convener. Jamie, do you want to go? Okay. And then I'll go to Linda.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome, gentlemen. Ms Small, the last time you were at the committee, you set out that it was Salus's overt intention to seek to add to the value that you believe an appropriately recruited and selected and then trained and supported NHS workforce can bring to the assessment and reassessment process for DWP PIP. And Mr Kennedy, you talked of putting the ethos of the NHS at the heart of your work. So I'm just wondering if you can set out how you're going about doing that.
I could start with I'm a director of HR, so the jobs part of this is very close to my heart. We have recruited, as Mark said, at the moment, something like 26 whole-time equivalents, and we anticipate that that will go up to 37 whole-time equivalents. And these are new jobs. They are jobs that we have used within Lanarkshire and with other health board partners, because obviously, as you know, we have centres that go way beyond Lanarkshire in the west of Scotland and Edinburgh City. And we have recruited those individuals from a combination of sources, some from the external market, some from our own redeployment register, where staff who are affected by organisational change find themselves in temporary roles or roles that are not as fulfilling as others. And so we use these opportunities in that area. We also use the opportunities to offer alternatives for staff who find themselves unable, through reasons of fitness to practice, to undertake, you know, other substantial roles within the NHS. So our experience, and the evidence is there to be seen, is that delivering against that aspiration to add substantive income and roles to the NHS in Scotland has been successful and will continue to be increasingly successful as we flex the workforce to meet the demands of the number of assessments as that grows. I think also from the perspective of Salus and its link with NHS Lanarkshire reputationally, I think the role that we are fulfilling, the evidence that we're getting back from ATOS and DWP's analysis of our performance stands the test of anyone in the UK. The complaints that Mark mentioned is something like 0.0007 of the activity. And the majority of those complaints are about people not being able to properly read the map that tells them where to go to get the assessments. Arguably, it's not even a complaint against the quality of the interaction around the assessment anyway. But we're doing something about making those maps better. You would be confident. So I think from the perspective of the ethos of the NHS and adding value, we're delivering that. I think, as you would imagine, we are also keen to make sure that that continues.
All I would add is that this whole structure within Salus has been set up to mirror the NHS. At all our sites, there's no concierge, there's no security, if you like, at it. It just runs like an outpatient department. And what we're finding from feedback from ATOS and DWP is people are respective of that and are happy with that in general, what the feedback I'm getting. We also, when we have our nurses and practitioners trained in this, there's a constant reminder that they're working for the NHS. This is a public service. These are the same individuals that come through your door, your GP and your previous jobs, and they should be treated with equal respect. It's hard not to go into nitty-gritty stuff. What there is that we're trying to instill is still a caring caring ethos around what we're doing. And we accept that it can't be easy for an individual to present himself for a disability assessment, and it's our job to make it as painless as possible for them. And we believe we're doing that to a high degree in the programme. I've not got any alarm bells ringing on, as you see from our complaints or anything.
That's helpful, Mr. Kenny. Thank you for that. In your paper, you say that the consultation duration is determined by the claimant. The claimant should be satisfied that they've had enough time to provide an accurate account of their position. I mean, how does that work in practice? No one can be told your time's up, go now, sort of thing? Or?
Yes, as it happens at the moment, we're saying our average time is around about 90 minutes to 100 minutes. Now, that on any given day, that normally means somebody will probably be there for an hour, that's all they need, and somebody may require 2 hours. Now, at the moment, our challenge is to manage that flux as best we can while still respecting the needs of the individual. We don't close down. What the health practitioners would be trained in, as you know, is to ask probing questions. You know, if people are going off track and off tangent, they're trained to bring it back into, you know, let's keep it about your functionality and how you're performing. But the whole idea, as Kenny said, it's a fairly simplistic approach. You sit down, and from the moment you open your eyes in the morning until you go back to your bed, tell us what happens in your average day and what happens in your most difficult day. And however long that takes at the moment is how long it's delivered.
And you've said there a couple of times that 90 to 110 minute appointment, sort of the average, and I think you made the point that I take on board, you know, that obviously allows for a fairly comprehensive assessment. But the flip side of that, I noticed when you spoke to the Scottish Social Security Consortium, they did express some concern that actually in some cases it could be too long for some disabled people. So obviously that's not an easy thing to do, but how do you square that circle?
What we're trying to instill with the staff there is to make a judgment on it. Where people get repetitive, we can intervene and say, have you anything to add that you haven't added on it? Or do you want to stress that point more now when you do it? Interestingly, when the consultation came up, we went through the whole journey for the individual, including the assessment process in detail. And I have to agree, I think 2 hours is an ask for somebody to come and sit in front of you and explain their day. So we try and keep it under that if we can, but we're very much aware that it has to be driven by the individual. We don't want accusations of I wasn't allowed to tell my story fully. So we manage it at the moment just within our appointment system. If somebody takes longer, we live in hope that somebody didn't, and we can shuffle it. What I think will settle down, a lot of the changes from the ATOS perspective and the consultation process have been efficiency and process around IT, and that has given us an extra probably about 15, 20 minutes that we didn't have when in the early days of this programme. So I don't have many episodes of it going over 2 hours, to be perfectly honest, that I'm told about. But the vast majority are around about an hour and a half, and we're not seeking to push that actively lower than that, to be perfectly honest. I think that's about the optimum duration.
I think this brings us back to the potential added value of the NHS. NHS health professionals are trained to speak to people. They're trained to speak to people in a language that they hopefully understand, and they're also trained in how to test and search people in communication without it appearing that way. And I think that is genuinely where we add value, that the core of the training of a health professional is about communication and engagement with people in a meaningful way. And I think whilst we have added to that training, I think the core training has been really, really important in terms of the success of our experience to date.
That begets another question which occurred to me earlier when you're answering my first question. Obviously, there could be another advantage given that this is within the NHS environment. Are your professionals undertaking the assessment picking up on other issues and able to refer individuals to other parts of the NHS?
Yes. We still, as the NHS, we're kind of unique in the fact that we still have a duty of care to any individual that presents in front of us. So yes, anybody with, for example, suicidal ideation, any chronic complaint that we think requires further examination, then we ask them and direct them to contact their GP immediately. And you know, that would be, we just function the same way we'd function in any other outpatient department of the NHS.
Okay, that's helpful. One final question about me. You say that this is in relation to the fact you've had few complaints and so on, that so far no penalty credits have been sanctioned against you. I don't know how much they want to tell us about this, but I mean, obviously it's good for Salus that hasn't happened thus far, but what are the arrangements and the circumstances that they can be applied, and how does all that work?
The contractual agreement with Salus has some service credits or penalty credits they have, and they are round about, you know, quality measures really. They come across that things like if somebody waits more than 30 minutes, for example, there'll be a charge against, you know, or a reduction in payment to Salus for that. And they're performance drivers. None of them affect the duration of the assessment. What some of them do is the quality of reporting. We submit reports to DWP, and they're banded A, B, or C. An A is a fabulous report, gives them all the detail that's required. A B is a report that, with some fine tuning, could be better and be of more value. And a C is what they determine as a failed. There's something fundamental in that assessment that needs changed. So we have threshold levels on those measures. And if we, for example, submit more than 5% of C reports, then there is a service penalty for that. They're kind of performance KPIs. To date, we haven't instilled any. Or in trouble.
Thank you.
Okay, Linda.
Yeah, thank you. Hi. I'd like to go back to something that the convener raised at the start, and I think it was yourself, Mark, who said that you haven't had any formal reporting back to Salus from DWP, and I just wondered what the system was in terms of that formal reporting back. Is it a time scale, one every so often, or is it after so many assessments? And what is it, what form will it take, and what do you expect to get from it?
Thanks, that's a good question. We're interested in that as well, because obviously that might help us add quality, and depending on what's within those reports. At the moment, it's a contractual arrangement between ATOS and DWP for reporting. So there is no direct mechanism between DWP and Salus for that. However, I would hope that DWP would soon be reporting early findings on PIP in the public arena, which then we could perhaps drill into as a percentage of that. We at the moment get informal reports from ATOS on claimant journey, satisfaction, and management information around how many slots and stuff like that. We don't get any qualitative evidence from them as yet, but we are actually asking up front. We would appreciate that as a public sector body.
Right, so you don't get back, for example, statistics on decisions taken and things relating to your assessments. Is that something you would expect in the future?
No, not within the contractual agreement we have. But obviously it's something we're interested in. But to my knowledge, there hasn't been a formal report on that, though members around the table may have more knowledge than me. So I haven't had anything other than informal rhetoric from DWP.
Okay, thanks. So do you think it would be useful to have that?
I would like to know. I'm not quite sure what we would do with just a flat statistical report. But yes, I think it would be good to know how many decisions are made regarding the reports we do.
I do think, as Mark described earlier, I do think the feedback we get in relation to the qualitative measurement of the assessment process is very useful, because we have a system in place that allows us to track right down to the individual health professional who is undertaking those assessments. And obviously, if there is a need to sit or to develop or train an individual further to improve their assessment process, then that's something we want to know about right away, so that we can take an immediate action in that respect. So I think in terms of the quality of the input, some of the feedback we are getting is very helpful indeed.
Thanks. Just another tack. I mean, I was really pleased about the consultation that you undertook at the start with the disability groups, etc. Seems like that's been fairly successful. I just wondered if it's something you intend to do on a regular or indeed an irregular basis, just to see how the perception is about the work you're doing.
I intend having a further event in September, at least offering one opportunity annually to come in and have a workshop on, what does this involve and what. It would be good for us, because at the moment we are reliant on customer feedback from the contractor, and it's a kind of wide sample of that. But we also know word of mouth and local working is valuable in this. So probably the workshop in September will be around, these organisations should have engaged a lot of people who have now been through PIP and had a decision or not. What's your view on that, and what are they telling you? So there is a learning issue for us in this. One of it might be around, I'm very interested in their experience of when they enter a Salus premises and when they leave. I have to, obviously, that we will not have any influence on changing any element of the assessment, but I am interested in what their experience is when they come across the door. I have to ensure that that's as good an experience as it can be. So again, annually, probably around September this year, we'll invite people back.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, Ken. Thanks, Camilla. Can I just, sorry if I'm going back to basics here on this, but just to confirm, you assess the claimants, but the decision made on how that affects their benefits is made by ATOS or DWP, and do they share any of that information with you? Do you know what parts of the assessment that you're carrying out to trigger changes in benefit assessment at all?
We do all the assessments. DWP do the decision making. ATOS don't do decision making. We do not know. The way the assessment works is it's basically you talk through the client's working or normal day, and you agree what is the best descriptor on that opportunity that they've had during the day, whether it's they're eating, sleeping, walking. Now those descriptors are scored, and I assume DWP add up those scores at the end of the day and makes a decision on both the score and the qualitative information that's provided in there. We don't encourage our staff to look at numbers at all. We just train them and suggest that the purpose of their role is to ensure that the best descriptor is chosen for it. So we don't get any feedback on the decision making. It's all done entirely by DWP. So although we've put 7,000 people through the assessment process, I have no knowledge at the moment how many of them have had a decision even.
So your test of how it works, you'll be trying to make sure that each of the assessors is conducted the same criteria each time, so that they're scoring compared to each other, compared to each of the claimants that's coming in, and you've no knowledge of how that information is then used. And will you at some point be told? I mean, will you? Because clearly there's a big dilemma here between a caring service and one that's becoming a gatekeeper. Will you be given that information about how the scores then trigger claimant?
No. As it's a contractual commercial arrangement. What we will have access to, like anybody else, is when DWP report it. But I will never get and you could argue nor should I, but I'll never get a report back that states of the so many thousand people you've assessed, X amount have either been successful in a claim or not.
So the because you've got a very low number of complaints about your service, which must be very gratifying, but it's also if that is simply an assessment of the sort of professionalism and care you're providing, the individual concerned might still be extremely unhappy with the decision that they face. But that complaint would then go to the GWP or ATOS, not to you, is that right?
That would go to DWP, and I imagine they would have to report, like they have done previously in work capability assessments, how many of those negative decisions went to appeal and were upheld, etc. So I won't.
When the patients, do you call them patients or claimants?
We call them patients, but that's because we're the NHS.
Yeah, that's right. And do they, when they come to see you, do they view you, do they view it as an interrogation? Do they see it as, do they know how much this matters to their benefit claim?
Oh, they know how much it matters to the benefit claim. The importance of their visit isn't lost on them at all. And obviously there's a degree of anxiety, you know, from anybody undertaking that. That's the whole idea about having the ethos and the quality staff of the NHS, that it's our job to try and relax them on that and make it as non-threatening as possible, not in order that we can do a good assessment. So that's what we aim to do. But yeah, they don't come naive to the assessment centres.
Have you been able to capture, it's a very difficult thing to capture, but the idea that you are a fair, impartial assessor, neither the setter or the criteria, but nor the judge and jury, in fact, in this, but you're simply carrying out a process which will be fair, will treat all claimants the same.
Yes.
And you think you've got that across quite well too.
Yes. As Kenny says, when we start to submit assessment reports, problematic reports are flagged up to us. So it's very easy to identify if one of our assessors is struggling with the individual in front of them or how to do it. So they obviously get more intensive training and support to improve on it. So I think we've got some quality measures in there that give us enough reassurance to know whether we're doing a good job or not.
And any of the delays that have been beset the larger programme, is there any delay in your part of it, or are you aware of that, or is it just you just simply provide them slots, they're filled?
I'm aware there's a backlog, not from our perspective, I have to say, but yeah, I think from the patient submitting a claim to DWP to getting to ATOS, to Salus, there's a significant period of time. We don't control or influence that because we provide our appointments a month in advance. So all we're reliant on is ATOS filling those appointments. So we don't influence how quickly the paper trail comes through DWP to ATOS to ourselves.
Just one other final thing. Are people allowed to bring somebody with them?
Oh, yes. It's encouraged to do so.
Yeah. Thank you, Lord.
Okay. Annabelle, to be followed by Kevin.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. Just a few questions. In terms of the current coverage of the Salus contract, I wonder if you have any idea what rough estimate of claimants or patients that would entail with respect to the total across Scotland. Have you any idea how that, how the Salus component fits in with respect to the rest, which is Atos?
Sure, I'm told it's somewhere between around about 55%, 50 to 60% is Salus.
Okay. And so we've heard already that as to outcomes, that's something that you're not aware of vis-a-vis the individual, because I was wondering how that would compare then with the Atos outcomes, both also in terms of the result, but in terms of how long it takes to get to see anybody, because I have a constituent in Fife who I referred to on a confidential basis in a debate in the Parliament the other week, who waited, I think, some 4.5 to 5 months to get an assessment from Atos, notwithstanding that that constituent had had major surgical intervention. So hopefully on the Salus side of things, it's not
I think the issue, same. Now, the issue is there that I wouldn't know, to be perfectly honest, because it has to be processed through Atos prior to coming to myself. I suspect that the people coming to Salus are waiting a degree of time before their appointment. However, they are written to probably about a month before their appointment with Salus. That's the only bit I can influence at all. And we have, maybe I haven't said in the paper, we have a do not attend rate of around a fifth. You know, so 1 in 5 people don't appear on the day and need to obviously reappointed. I think that is an issue, that the waiting time for the claimant from their original submission is too long.
Okay, and are there, is there a possibility for a home visit if the circumstances require?
Yes, I should clarify that Salus only provide face-to-face across the venues mentioned. There are two other types of process for assessment. One is to do with a very quick paper turnaround in terms of like critical illness and, you know, terminal illness, which is a paper referral that Atos do. Anybody who's also assessed by Atos is requiring a domiciliary assessment is done by Atos.
Okay. In terms of the actual part of the process that you're engaged in, and you referred a moment ago to the descriptor approach, and also you referred to the fact that qualitative information is also included. Can you provide a wee bit more information? I mean, in your average case, seeing a patient for their assessment, to what extent would there be additional written information to deal with the information surrounding a descriptor, because our confidence in the descriptor approach, at least in terms of the work capability assessment, isn't very high, because it doesn't seem to allow you to give additional information that's relevant.
There's two stop gaps for this. There is choosing of the descriptor, you know, which is a process in itself. What the health practitioner has to do then is justify why that descriptor has been chosen. Now, that tends to be where if we submit C-level reports, as in like unsatisfactory reports, it tends to come back from Atos and DWTs say that the justification didn't meet the choice. So we have to put a bit of work in to say, okay, we've chosen this descriptor and this is the rationale why, and then they'll write things like the client has stated on two occasions or frequently, blah, blah, blah. So they have to justify that, and there's a number of descriptors, and at the end of the assessment, they also have to summarise all of the descriptors. So there's a kind of second test, if you like, the write-up. So the write-up has to marry the small summary under the descriptors. Now, I think Atos and DWB might be looking at the second summary. It's kind of like a short essay on why all these descriptors have been chosen, and with a view to perhaps refining that somewhat. But we have to provide more evidence than just ticking the box to say this is descriptor chosen. They have to demonstrate why. DWP then assess that to see if it's relevant and feedback to us directly if it's not. So there is a check.
Okay, and one last question at this point, Commissioner. So in the case of the work capability assessment process, which we have been trying to get to the bottom of, obviously the more hard and fast medical information, stricto sensu, that is enclosed with the application, the better the applicant seems to fare. And I just wonder, how does that work with respect to Salus, given that you are yourselves an arm of the NHS in Scotland?
The same opportunity is given to the patient when they attend. They're invited by DWT to submit further medical evidence of their claim to DWP, but also if they have further since their submission, to bring it to Salus. So we do have patients arriving with poly bags full of evidence of various sophistication. We are duty-bound and contractually bound, although we would do it anyway, to view every single piece of evidence that comes. Now, that was one of the issues around the assessment duration, that if somebody arrives with 40 pieces of individual evidence, we have to both log it and consider it in the assessment. Now, what we are encouraging DWP to do, or ATOS are via a number of other partners, is to try and give more detail to the claimant on what would be seen as a priority evidence. You know, because we'll get various things from, it can be as simple as a receipt from a taxi to say, I need a taxi to get places, or it can be a two-page letter from your GP strongly advising, but people bring everything. So we're asking DWP to prioritise and give a wee bit more advice to people on what would help their claim. But it has to be assessed and be part of the assessment.
Okay. Thank you.
Then Alex.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, gentlemen. We have information which says that the administration cost for DLA was £49 per claim, compared with £182 for PIP, and the expected average decision time on a new claim for DLA was 37 days for PIP. This is 74 days. Now, you've already explained in part of your answer to Mr. McIntosh that a lot of these timescales are out of your hands, and you're governed by the DWP and ATOS in terms of the timescales. Do you think that reflects in Salus? Do folk come in to your offices and moan about the level of time that they have to wait and the bureaucracy around this new process?
We have had occasional, individuals at our reception saying, I'm so glad to be here, it's taken so long to get here. So I think that's why I was saying that the waiting duration is too long. I think it wouldn't be acceptable within the NHS, so why is it acceptable within this process? But you are right, I have no control over how that works within this arrangement we have.
Back to ATOS and to the DWP and say that folks have said this. Yes. And obviously you said that they wouldn't have to wait that long if it was an NHS appointment. And, you know, you are an offshoot of the NHS. What are folks' reaction to that? Because sometimes, you know, folks don't get these kind of differences.
I have to say that anecdotally, we get more patients or claimants coming through our doors that say things like, we're really happy you're doing this and it's not being done by somebody else. So there is an acceptance, and I think rightly so, a degree of trust in the NHS with how we'll perform this. With respect to, you know, whether it can be shortened or not, because it's commercially contracted via WP, we can only make recommendations, and we do feedback on a monthly basis to ATOS to say our major concerns this month have been. And usually a consistent one within that is that people are mentioning, you know, the delay and the length it takes to get to this. The other thing I have to say is once Salus assess the individual, I also have no idea how long it takes a decision maker to process that. So we are, I take your point, we are in a kind of unusual position where if we owned this end-to-end, we would look to actively make some efficient changes in it. But
you wouldn't have seen a doubling in the average waiting time for a claim.
I would like to think not.
Right. I think that's extremely useful. At the beginning of the session here, you said, and I paraphrase, and I think it was Mr. Small, NHS officials are trained to deal with patients and have the right level of communication. Now, one of the things which we have found from other sessions that we've had with ATOS and the DWP, it seems that communication
is a major failing in terms of dealing with these assessments. In terms of what you are doing, have you indicated to them the differences between your style and their style in terms of trying to bring others up to the standards that you seem to have in this regard?
I mean, certainly the conversations I've been involved in with ATOS and also with Mark and through Mark with his colleagues is almost to look at that from the other end of the telescope. I think that ATOS absolutely recognise the added value that the NHS brings. They certainly seem to recognise the Salus performance when they look at that across the UK in relation to communication and delivery. It has certainly been a subject of conversation that we've been involved in with ATOS about how they might prefer to run this entire contract across the UK or indeed across the whole of Scotland. But that requires either a change in the approach or a change in the interest from the public sector or the NHS in terms of becoming involved in this work.
Taking that Mr. Small may not be able to answer this, but you're describing a situation where the NHS would be better placed to deal with this rather than have these private contracts in the first place. Would I be right in saying that?
I wouldn't necessarily go as far as you've just stated, but I would certainly see, as we did from the outset and certainly articulated when we first came here, that the NHS is in a very strong position because of the nature of the training and the skills, as you've described them, of our staff, to get the best out of people when they are in the pressurised situation that Mark has described, giving the information on which we create the assessment. We don't treat this as a business. We treat it as a patient contact, and that's part of the reason why it takes so long. I believe it's also part of the reason why the quality feedback that we get in terms of the key performance indicators is the way it is. It almost couldn't be better.
Mr. Kennedy, you talked of logging in individual pieces of information that folks bring. And one of the things which I've certainly had, and I'm sure colleagues are exactly the same, is where folks feel that those bits of paper, which they think prove that they have certain difficulties, are often disregarded. So that logging process, have you suggested to colleagues in ATOS and the DWP that this should become the norm?
Well, it should be the norm already. We are under contract to record every piece of evidence that comes with the client. To touch on my previous response to that, what I was suggesting was there's a vast range and the weighting of some of that evidence would carry more weight than others. And that was the request to ATOS to, why can we not put this more out in the public realm? As in, like, you know, if you, you know, obviously a letter or a substantial report from a healthcare professional will carry a lot of weight in this process, but also something from a neighbour who says, I've seen, you know, the individual struggle putting his bin out or something like that, wouldn't carry the same weight, but you could argue was a vital piece of information. So we're trying to get some clarity around, you know, what's the best form of evidence to present with your claim, and have fed that back to ATOS. What ATOS have done via the DWP on that, I'm unsure at the moment.
One final question, convener, and that's round about the phrase that you use, duty of care. The NHS has a duty of care. Do you feel that some of the other contractors, some of the decision makers in the DWP, do you feel that they have that duty of care? And if they do, do they actually adhere to it?
I would ask you to ask them that question, to skirt round it. I know we perform our duty of care in this programme. I should also say, in relation to your earlier comment, I would love to see our performance in relation to the other companies across the UK. I would welcome that. Whether I will or not, I'm not sure. And also, maybe in response to add on Kenny's response to your early question, I remember the discussions at Lanarkshire Health Board when this was brought to the table. And most of the discussion around that was, what makes us better at doing this than anybody else? And I reiterate that the NHS deals with disability every day, every minute of every day. And our view was that I don't see anybody better placed to deliver this service in Scotland.
Thank you. I think that's been very useful, convener.
Alex.
Thank you. A couple of brief questions, maybe slightly different from the others you've had. First of all, can you confirm that you are working as subcontractors to Atos? Atos has kind of made it clear that I think that they don't want to have their contract extended with the DWP. Does that affect your contractual position in the longer term?
No, the Atos withdrawal from work capability assessment is an entirely different contract.
What I wondered was, given that Atos have made that indication, have you found anything in the model that you have been operating that could be extended into the other areas that Atos currently work in?
From limited knowledge of work capability assessment, because we don't particularly we don't have anything to do with work capability assessment. I think Atos are learning that there is a different approach to have with the claimant in terms of process, and it doesn't need to be as harrowing sometimes than it currently is. There are bits and pieces that they've commented on with the fact that one, they were surprised that we didn't have any security on site, and we took the view, as I said before, that these are individuals who access the NHS, so why would you? And we have several people, if you like, who have claimants, patients who have been through the process, have already been through a work capability assessment and are now applying for a PIP, who are basically saying it's night and day, it's a totally different experience for them. So I think culturally there's something Atos or other providers in this could learn from. You'll accept that it's not my job to teach them. However, it would be nice for a summary at some point involved in this. Atos, as you know, though, won't be involved in work capability assessments going forward. So I'm not quite sure of their other portfolio in welfare other than PIP.
The final question is really a repeat of part of the question I asked previously. But could you see an organisation like Salus at some point in the future being involved in things like work capability assessments?
I have to be honest and say I'm unsure how to answer that. I can see from what I've said already, I went on record to say that there is nobody better placed to look at the functionality of an individual than the NHS. So I would say from a clinical point of view that there's no reason why that wouldn't be the case still in assessing whether somebody's fit for work or not. However, like yourselves, or maybe not all of you around the table, but we have some reticence around the current work capability assessment infrastructure and structure, and we are making no moves to enter that market at this place.
I mean, the immediate answer to the question is, and Mark's maybe just too embarrassed to say it, but Salus's core role for NHS Lanarkshire involves workplace capability assessment. That's a core part of their job for the staff of NHS Lanarkshire. So they are very, very experienced and I believe very diligent and successful at conducting that role for NHS Lanarkshire and indeed for other employers across Scotland and beyond as part of an occupational health service. So the experience is there.
Same question once more in different words. If Atos weren't there and the contract was up for grabs, could you do the job better?
I don't think we could answer that.
I keep trying.
Can I come back? One more question from me in relation to the process, just to get a comparison between how you operate and the Atos with the work capability assessment operated. It took us a long time to get clarification on the process and the differential between Atos assessment centres and the work they do and the decision makers at the DWP. And part of the confusion centred around the reports that were done by Atos being sent to the claimant so that they knew what the Atos assessment had concluded, if you like. Although no decision had been made, the decision was made by the decision makers, and they could add points to the assessment based on further information and what have you. So there was a lot of confusion because people were receiving these reports from Atos, which gave an indication of the points that had been awarded at that assessment. But that was not the decision. The decision was made later based on that assessment. Is that the same process that you have to undertake? Do the claimants that come before Salus receive a report with or without points attached? You know, but do they get a report based on what you assess them?
To my knowledge, they will get a report. Now, that report will be provided via DWP, but to my knowledge, that comes with the decision making. I'm not aware, now it might be my naivety, I have to say, I'm not aware of them receiving a report prior to a decision being made. I couldn't understand why that would be relevant.
They don't get one from us.
They don't get one from Salus.
No, there was a lot of confusion because people were coming to us and saying that they had been made aware that ATOS had given them certain points. And ATOS were saying, but we don't make the decision. But people assumed that we were making the decision. It was actually...
I can see your point in that. All I can say is, fundamentally, Salus do not provide anybody who's been assessed with the report. I'm uncertain what ATOS do with that report, but I can't see any reason to provide somebody with a report, a scored report, without a decision, yes or no, being with that report.
Yeah, it was just in case any of that same confusion was occurring in relation to this, if you had identified any of those kind of...
I'll take that back and clarify that. That would be helpful,
Mark, if you could do that, because, as I said, it took us a long time to pin down exactly why this confusion was occurring, because people were coming to us saying ATOS decided I wasn't to receive the benefit, but ATOS didn't make the decision. But people were being given their reports, which indicated what the ATOS assessment had concluded in terms of points. But that didn't necessarily mean that that's what the DWP decision makers had decided, and it created quite a bit of confusion, and certainly a lot of claimants were finding difficulty in coming to terms with the differential between the report that they received and the final decision.
The detail of that would be in the contract between ATOS and DWP. I'm not aware of ATOS having that behaviour in PIP, but I will clarify whether that's the case or not.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of it, I think, with just to clarify, a lot of the confusion led to ATOS being blamed for a lot of the decisions which actually had been made by the DWP. And I've been very concerned to make sure that the responsibility for these assessments lies with those who make those assessments, and that's the DWP, not either yourselves as Salus acting a subcontractor for ATOS or ATOS themselves. I think it's absolutely vital that we ensure that people are aware that these decisions are made by the DWP, and it's the DWP's assessments that are being operated here.
Our health assessors also feed that back to the patients when they arrive, to put their mind at rest that it's not going to be the individual in front of them that's going to make a judgment of them on this, and we explain that that is done by DWP.
Okay. Do you have any other comments that you'd like to make? Is there anything you think we haven't covered that you would like to make us aware of? Or?
I suppose only the fact that the introduction of the reassessment of DLA, the natural reassessment, is due to commence, I think, around about October. And at that point, we'll have individuals who are currently in receipt of benefit coming for assessment. So I think really just want to go on record that that's not lost on us. That will be a difficult time for both the claimants and possibly Salus when we're doing our job to objectively assess. But that doesn't come into play until I'm told October.
We'll watch out for that again. You maybe find yourself being invited to come back and tell us how things are progressing, because we certainly want to keep on top of that. We've had the DWP officials and ATOS on a number of occasions giving us updates. So, if things are going well with the Salus application of the process, then all well and good. But obviously, as a committee, we want to make sure that that continues. And if you can come back to us with good news, then we'll hopefully have the opportunity at some point in the future for that to happen.
I suppose the only other thing I would add is again to repeat the invitation to MSP colleagues to visit any of the sites. We've had one or two of your colleagues come to Glasgow in particular. The difficulty being, you can see the site, you can see how it operates, you can't necessarily speak to the clients or patients unless that's they're prepared to do that. But one or two of your colleagues have found that useful.
That's really helpful, Kenny. We'll probably take you up on that. We've gone out to all the other centres and made sure that we're as aware of the process as we possibly can be, so that any deliberations we have are as informed as we can make them. Okay, but thanks very much to you both for coming through this morning again. Appreciate your time. Okay, I'll suspend for a couple of minutes to let the witnesses change. Members will recall that Linda Fabiani was off to North America, so we sent her with a mission, which she chose to undertake before the report or the recording self-destructed. It was to see how food banks worked over there, and Linda, you took the opportunity to do that. So do you want to give us a report back and colleagues the opportunity to discuss what you discovered when you were there?
Yeah. Yes, thank you, convener. It was really interesting. I was out in North America in April during Scotland Week, as the convener said, so took the opportunity to visit the New York City Human Resources Administration, Department of Social Services, and also with the Ontario Association of Food Banks when I was in Toronto. First of all, New York, I met with the team of Cecile Knoll, who was the Executive Deputy Commissioner, Emergency and Intervention Services. The main points that came out of that was that the department itself provides adult protective services, and it's a coverall. So food provision is also in the same department as domestic violence. and they actually also have what they call emergency feeding services, which was interesting. They've got 500 programmes of food bank support in New York City through the emergency feeding services, and that's about 50% of the support in the city. They receive state and federal funding amounting to £8.3 million equivalent for their food banks. Most of the service provides food pantries, and 25% of it is actually the provision of soup kitchens, as we imagine them to be, people turning up to be fed within a specific place. They have found a recent fairly sharp increase in families using the services other than their main client group, which was always single people before. They also operate a food stamp scheme, and they've introduced a debit card scheme, which they hope will cut down on the degree of corruption that's been there. Mainly, I have to say, by the retail outlets as opposed to the individual. They pay a supplement onto the debit card, which can be used at any store, but already they're finding that there's some malpractice getting involved with that as well. There's more than 1.5 million New Yorkers who receive food stamps. They apply an income-based eligibility criteria to the debit card scheme, and there's 1.8 million people use it. The maximum US dollars is $189 per month per person, and it depends on the household size, expenses and clients' income. And they can use the debit card and food banks. Food banks are non-judgmental, if you like. People can turn up, so there's no question asked about whether they're also in receipt of anything else. They started to also operate a food stamp nutrition outreach programme, trying to give education about food as well. They work very closely with supermarkets and other food companies about increasing donations of healthy, nutritious food, and they're starting to operate cooking classes and workshops. It's all run under an umbrella organisation called Food Bank New York City, and they have a formal arrangement with supermarkets to offload surplus food. I'll come back to this at the end, but just to finish in the New York City experience, I think what really struck me was that it was just part of the fabric of what happens as part of what seemed to be a social service. There was no real strategic approach to the provision, but really just a reliance on the voluntary sector to plug the gaps, and an expectation that would happen because it has ever been thus. Moved on to Toronto, it was a bit different, and it's the Ontario Association of Food Banks, and they're voluntary and don't receive any government funding, completely autonomous, and individual food banks affiliate to the Ontario Association of Food Banks, which started in 1992. It struck me that our own experience, limited though it is, of Trussell, is moving along that same model. They've got 127 food banks as members and 1,100 affiliates for hunger relief programmes and agencies across the province. They have a more holistic approach than I found in New York. They're trying to address the root causes of hunger, and you know, they talk about, as you know, others do, sustainable solutions, wanting to make food bank use unnecessary. The first Canadian food bank came in 1982, and what they were saying is that since then, food banks have gone from being that sort of temporary solution to a need. It grew from the grassroots and was born out of the church system, like so many of these things are. You can go to a food bank once a month and receive 3 to 4 days' food, which is intended to get you through to the end of the month. So whilst they're not judgmental, they do have a limit on how many visits someone can make. They were saying that they have particular issues in rural areas, and I remember that came up here when we had our session about the stigma and the loss of dignity associated with everyone knowing where you go. They don't do food stamps or vouchers. 2.8% of the population in Toronto are served by the food banks. They're also finding a big increase, in the use of food banks, households coming for the first time. 69% of the client's primary source of income is social assistance and disability support. I found this statistic really high when they said that most recipients are rental tenants and spend 71% of their income on housing. I mean, I have to say, when I asked whether, because I know in Ontario, if you rent a house, sometimes it includes the utilities, etc., and a degree of furniture, but there wasn't the statistic that broke that down that would enable us to compare, because we tend not to have these things included in rent. So they have a very varied clientele, and again, they feel the average food bank user uses it for 1 year to 18 months, and they reckon that less than 5% of their users are long-term. Recent drivers of demand since 2008, food bank use increased by 28% between 2008 and 2009 and hasn't fallen since. So I guess what they were saying was they reckon it was the impact of the recession, but actually the recession was relatively mild in Canada compared to other places. Their politics at the moment in Ontario would perhaps account for some of that as well, those in control. As I said earlier, they're very holistic in their approach. They campaign as well, the Ontario Food Banks Association, because they see it as a symptom of poverty, and they're trying to create community hubs to address the much wider issues. So they've got a big focus as well on promoting healthy food. They also work with the five major grocery chains in Canada. What their conclusion was that food banks are plugging the gaps in state provision. And whilst they said they felt there was a danger that it became institutionalised and became mainstream support, they also recognised the view that if this started in 1982 and has just been increasing and increasing, perhaps it is the case that it's already mainstream support and is becoming institutionalised for all that government, either local or national, doesn't support food banks directly. They also said to us, and I have to say on a personal level, I pick it up from my family when I'm there quite often, is that people just automatically give to food banks. It's just something that is done and that people see as one of their responsibilities. And it just happens. The Ontario Local Food Act means that farmers can claim a 25% tax credit, which is based on the fair market value of food donated to food banks and other charitable meal programmes. So even at that level, you get farmers directly supplying food banks. One of the things that the Ontario Association said that they thought we should take on board, and we asked that question, was that we should get very firm information in order to monitor trends in use, characteristics of food bank users, etc. It's only comparatively recently that they undertook to do that, and they've been very surprised at the findings. We've already heard evidence of that kind of work ongoing. They did also say that they thought we should set standards for use, for example, feed people in need, not on the grounds of any other criteria, and have a code of conduct in terms of decent treatment. I think, just to conclude from my own views of hearing about, I found some of it really quite depressing, I have to say, in terms particularly of what's happening here in Scotland today, and that we've heard evidence about, because it was almost like looking at it and thinking, unless something very big happens to change things here, that's the road down which we are heading. The big difference between New York City and Ontario, from what I picked up, is that even at official level in New York City, they didn't really get what I was saying about we're worried that it becomes mainstream and institutionalised, because for them it always has been, and they didn't really understand that distinction. But certainly what was very telling was the Ontario Association absolutely got what I was saying, and were very frustrated that they had suffered from provision creep, if you like, and it had become institutionalised without anybody knowing. For me, that's the big warning for us. If that's not what we want in our society, we have to get that big warning out there and not allow ourselves to get pulled into this is just the way things are and this is what happens, and fight very hard against it. So that's all I'd like to say.
That sounds very interesting, Linda. Just an observation rather than a question. Based on your sort of last comments there, I was reading an article a little while ago which was making the point about, you know, the different views that people can have of this system. You know, that we take great pride in having a welfare system. We provide a lot of things because society should do it. So we take great pride in the benefit system. We take great pride in free school meals and various other things that are provided. But there's always the sense that those who are in receipt of the benefits and those who have to make the claims feel stigmatised and you know, don't want to do it. And therefore, when we have things like food banks, there's a sense of shame that we have to have them here. But in other parts of the world, there's a sense of pride that they provide them. And it's a cultural thing, I think. And is that what you picked up? It's just a cultural thing. But that contained in that is that danger that it becomes an institutionalised thing.
I think that's absolutely right. And if you excuse my personalising it again, I did talk quite seriously with some of my relatives about that. Canadians who are very supportive through their local church of the food banks. And that's the kind of thing I was trying to put across. And yes, they are quite proud of the fact that their church does so much. They're quite proud of the fact that their children automatically do it the same as they do, and that they've brought that together. When we talked about it further, I think for them was the realisation that they had made it normal and that there were people who were relying on charitable handouts. And I guess that made them think a bit. And that's the danger, I think, is that we get into that same culture. I mean, yes, I'm proud of the fact that Loaves and Fishes and Dennis and Cathy Curran do such great work and that some of the local churches do it. But it's back to the reality is there will always be people who need that kind of provision, you know, for whatever reason, for a very short time or maybe even longer. But what Dennis was saying is the client group has changed, and that's what we have to guard against, basically saying we should not have hungry families and hungry children in our towns, cities and rural areas. And that's, for me, what we have to guard against institutionalising. And as I called it, food bank creep, if you like. I think that's very much what has happened in Ontario and perhaps other parts of Canada. And it's certainly not something I want to see.
Yeah. Any other colleagues have comments or questions for Linda? Yeah. Ken?
Just very briefly, you said very clearly that the biggest rise recently in Canada was because of the recession. Mm-hmm. It's rather unfair to ask you this because you were just visiting them. You won't be able to do any research on it. But are you aware of any welfare changes in the Canadian system? Because there is evidence from Germany, for example, that welfare changes there drove a huge increase. I was wondering whether...
Well, I can only... I mean, you know, when I relayed that, that was what directly came from the officers of the Association of Food Banks. I can't speak with any basis in research, Ken, about anything like that. Anecdotally, I can say yes, there have been over the past few years changes, certainly in the Ontario welfare system. And I know that some of them have been driven at a federal level down to the provinces. Whether or not that has had a direct effect, I don't have the knowledge to comment on.
I think it is very interesting, Convener, just particularly the interaction between the state and voluntary programmes and the, as Linda put it, the danger of food bank creep and whether or not we wish to support that actively or actually go in a different direction.
Yeah. Alex?
Interesting to hear what Linda has to say about the particularly Canadian experience and the suggestion that the recession may have been the cause of the increase in demand. What worries me is that this the creep that she describes has the effect that where there's pressure for increased demand, demand increases. And when that pressure ceases to exist, demand doesn't reduce proportionally. So I wondered if we might actually seek information on whether there are any examples of countries in the world where demand has been significantly managed downwards at any time.
Well, we've got a helpful briefing from Spice on food banks. If Spice continue to watch that and can come up with any evidence, then we would welcome it, I would imagine. But I don't know if, you know, I'll speak to Spice and see if there is more work that can be done. But I found that their briefing on food banks to be quite helpful, because as I said, I read an article, but I was sort of guided towards that by what I'd read in the Spice document. So it's something I'm sure Spice will keep an eye on for us, and if there is evidence to that effect, Alex, I'm sure they'll get it to us. Ken?
Just, I believe we were going to talk about this in an informal session because Spice aren't at the table to give evidence. Just my own thoughts on this. The evidence on the face of it from Germany is that welfare change was very much part of the increase. I think anecdotally, as Linda's alluded to, I think there have been welfare changes in Canada too, which have accompanied the recession. We might want to discuss this in private session, but in my view, it might be worth conducting a literature review of this because it's quite important for our own report on food banks, and particularly the relationship between the rise in food banks, the recession, and the welfare changes. There seem to be parallels, less in America. The American situation seems to be slightly different, if I may say so. But the Canadian example and the German examples certainly had, I believe, some helpful, maybe not lessons, but certainly information that we could share.
Right, Ken, we can take that up when we come to look at our report on food banks and where we can draw information to assist that. So that's where that will lead us. I think that's concluded that part of our business. We come then to our next item, which is the annual report. It's a very standardised process. The format's there to create the report every year. Colleagues have had a chance to see it. Are you happy with the content of it? Jamie, you want to make a comment?
I'm entirely happy with the content of it. The only thought I had was that we could maybe add a little to it in terms of the engagement and innovation section. We've undertaken a number of informal visits over the course of the year. For example, Ken and myself went to visit Deafblind Scotland in Lindsay. I went to visit New Horizons Borders in Gala Shields. Yourself and Annabelle went to the Glasgow Disability Alliance. A number of us went to various food banks in our own constituency, and I think maybe a report would benefit by just reflecting that as well.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think the clerks are happy to do that. Any other comments?
Alex? That I would ask is something that we've done previously, and note my objection to the use of the term bedroom tax.
Right. We'll work that in as normal. Okay. Any other comments from colleagues? In which case then, as agreed at the start of today's meeting, we now move into private session. Thanks, everyone.